Next session, no messing around. This is, I had a chance to chat with these gentlemen before we began, and I am very much looking forward to this conversation. We have two gentlemen who are going to continue this theme of thinking outside of the government, and yet we have one cheater. And I'll tell you about him in just a moment. First, though, I want to tell you about Aaron Levie, who's the co-founder of Box, is the chairman and chief executive officer there. And I learned something about him that I did not know, and I am sorry that I didn't bring a deck of cards, because we talked a little bit about magic just a few moments ago, and Aaron is an accomplished magician. He's great with card tricks. And so maybe, did you bring a deck?
No.
Dang it. He, of course, is behind Box, and Box is making entries into the federal market, but Aaron is going to talk to us about continuing the themes that we've discussed already this morning. Ryan Panchadsaram is a former Presidential Innovation Fellow, now the Deputy Chief Technology Officer at the Office of Management and Budget. And I am very much looking forward to hearing them. Gentlemen, come on up. To hearing them continue the conversation as they started to get to know each other in the last couple of days. It's a pleasure to have both of you here.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thanks for having us here. Appreciate
nice to see you. Welcome.
What do you want to do?
Here, I'll stay
right there. Good. Okay.
How's everyone?
Good.
Awesome.
All right. Yeah, and I think we were promised this would be very interactive, so feel free to like shout out questions at any point, I think, is the whole idea. Is that accurate?
That's fine.
Great, okay, perfect.
Awesome. Cool. Maybe we could, I guess like the quick like correction of the introduction is that, so I'm the Deputy Chief Technology Officer for the U.S., so the entire federal government being the area that I focus on. I think an interesting history of both Aaron and I is that we both are born from the breed of enterprise. I used to work at Salesforce.com before this and Microsoft, and then went into government. I think you're not going to find two people that are so bullish about enterprise tech anywhere.
Yes, it's kind of awkward, actually. No, we don't have many friends because of it, but it's like literally in Silicon Valley, it's pretty uncool. But
yeah.
We've both done this, so. Yeah, and we're on our end. We just started entering the federal space, so now we're taking a lot of the lessons that we've learned from the enterprise side and trying to bring it into the federal government.
Aaron, what are you seeing? I mean, because we're actually going to go back and forth, maybe pepper and poke each other with like different kinds of questions. And my big curious one here is that I think what gap are you seeing? Right, like you spend most of your time working with the Fortune 500. The Fortune 500 have missions just very much like a lot of the agencies. Right, agencies are kind of companies in themselves. Like, what are you seeing in that space? Are you seeing a gap starting to form? Like, how bad is it?
Yeah. So, so for us, we so if you're in Silicon Valley, raise your hand and maybe if you who visits the Valley. Okay, and who just doesn't come out here, out there? Oh man, okay, we gotta bring you out here, out there, sorry. I don't even know where I am, because it took 2 hours to get here. So, sorry, Sonny. So, you know, out in the Valley, the breaking news, I think, for everyone here is the government is this very mysterious sort of, just like nobody knows how to work within the government if you're a startup. And so the big challenge that we see is this potential divergence over time that's going to emerge between the kind of technology that the private sector has and what large corporations can get, because there's so many new innovations that the startup community is building, and what the government sector and government space is going to be able to bring into institutions and agencies. And so, you know, we're able to work in the federal space because we're 10 years old. We have nearly 1,300 employees. We can afford to kind of work through the sort of systems and complexity that obviously, you know, a lot of agencies have. But when we were 5, 10, 50, 100, 200 employees, we didn't know how to enter this market.
Yeah.
And the big challenge that we see is, you know, a lot of people think that you know, Silicon Valley is in this bubble right now, but actually what is happening is that there's so many new companies being formed to go solve really, really complex problems for organizations. So, you know, we tend to think about Silicon Valley as sort of just focused on the consumer side, but actually there's so much innovation on the enterprise side. There are new startups coming every single day, And so the big challenge, but ideally opportunity if we can kind of figure this out together, is how do you get those same innovations that are emerging every day for the private sector to be able to enter in the government space? And I think that's going to be a big challenge. That's going to be, we have to obviously look through all the procurement processes that the government faces. We have to find ways of having more accelerated ways of doing FedRAMP, for instance. These are all going to be pretty important if we're going to have all the innovation from Silicon Valley be able to get infused in the government.
The one thing I'm saying too, it's like that's like a technology choice, right? You know, most like traditional, if they're going to build or buy, like using something like Box, using like something like Google Docs, using like something that just comes off the shelf is like a really powerful thing. I think that even like translates a little bit to the technology choices that we're being forced to make. I think if you rewind back maybe 10 years ago or even 5 years ago, there was this split between enterprise tech choices and consumer tech choices. One of the big pushes that we're trying to encourage is like make the same decisions that the large companies are doing. And in this case, when it comes to the web and web technologies, those large companies are the Facebooks, the Twitters, the Amazons of the world and how they do business, right?
Well, and if you look at something like an Uber, and we work with Chris quite a bit. I mean, when you think about a company that has emerged just in the past 5 years, I mean, now they're actually a massive organization in terms of their complexity and their scale, but they've been able to invent their IT model from scratch, mm-hmm. Using best-in-class technologies around their entire business. Now, that's really, really hard to do if you're in an institution that's been around for 50, 100, or 150 years. You can't rapidly do that. And so the challenge, though, is where can we find the areas of an organization where you can think about the much more modern ways of doing things? And that's I think the opportunity that every agency and every organization faces. But it's going to take obviously a lot of leadership. It's going to take a lot of choices to be able to work through that, because it means that you can't be consumed with all of the time spent on the Oracle system if we're actually trying to drive innovation with some of these new products.
One of the big areas where we're seeing like that kind of gap is in infrastructure, right? I was part of the team that helped turn around parts of healthcare.gov about 2 years ago. And it was a very interesting world when you got there, because it was a world where a lot of the infrastructure was bare metal, right? Mm-hmm. If any of us here were to start a company today, or even the practices that they use at their company today, what you would do is actually go use a real good, healthy cloud hosting provider. Right. If you look at the digital services playbook, one of the plays is use a flexible hosting environment, one where you can provision when you need to, you can go to different availability zones. Like you thinking about managing that shouldn't be part of at least my day job. And so that's one of the big shifts that we're trying to see.
Well, we're seeing in the Fortune 500, more and more CIOs are actually, they need justification as to why an application wouldn't be in the cloud.
That's cool.
So we were with a major banking CIO just last week, and this CIO will not let his team deploy a non-cloud technology mm-hmm. unless there's some pretty significant rationale as to why you would do that. So it's a pretty significant change. Now, what that is going to drive is then a change in his own kind of talent in his organization, because it's not going to be about managing infrastructure.
Yeah.
It's not going to be about systems. It's not going to be about maintaining the bare metal. It's going to be about delivering value at a different layer of the stack. And so the big opportunity, both for the private sector and the public sector, is what if we can actually move up the stack pretty rapidly and get a bunch of services, whether it's storage, whether it's compute, whether it's basic applications, that create a new bar for what government technology looks like. And then the value from an IT standpoint is at the layer above that. It's integrating and fusing these technologies together. It's delivering digital experiences that reach out to the consumer. So we can't do that if all of the time and all of the energy is spent on the pure infrastructure side.
Help debunk one thing, right? So Box has incredible verticals, right? You're in finance, you're in health, you're in some pretty hard areas. Like, is security that hard? Is encryption that hard? Is like, what are you seeing across them? Because I think one thing in government, sometimes we like to think we're different. I used to come from the healthcare space. We used to think we're different. How different are we?
You are very different.
Okay.
I
didn't know.
I want to underscore that point right now. A very different beast. The requirements from a security standpoint are not that different.
Okay.
So just to separate those two concepts. So on the security side, you know, imagine if you're Goldman Sachs or you're Morgan Stanley or you're JP Morgan or you're US Bank or you're Aetna or you're Stanford Hospital or MD Anderson, the cybersecurity threats facing your business mm-hmm. are massive. They're enormous. People are trying to do money laundering. People are trying to steal healthcare records and patient information so they can do medical fraud. So the severity of an attack or a hack is significant in the private sector as much as it is in the public sector. So the requirements around how do you encrypt, how do you secure data, how do you have robust, performant, highly available infrastructure is just as high in the private sector. Yeah. So the question is not, are the needs that different? It's just, what are the tools available? What are the processes to procure those technologies? And who are the vendors that are willing to go and work with either either ecosystem? So for us, because we've worked through financial services and healthcare, we have 45,000 customers, so we have a certain amount of scale where we've been able to learn a lot of the requirements and a lot of the different significant issues of these industries. That puts us in a better position now to come to the government with a lot of learnings from the private sector. Now, we would not have done that 5 or 6 years ago because we just did not have that scale. We did not have those capabilities. And I think, again, that's the risk is that divergence of the type of technology. But for us, for our model, where we power secure sharing of content and files, you are going to get way better security in a cloud-oriented model for that type of product than you will in an on-premises model, because in an on-premises model, you're inviting people into your network. You're inviting people into your DMZ where that's exactly, I don't know what flies in the government, but that's exactly how the Snowden thing was like. The second you get into a SharePoint site, you get to everything. You get to navigate whatever you want. So it's actually the on-premises model for sharing and collaborative technologies is less secure because you have all these new points of vulnerability that aren't containerized, that aren't isolated out. And so that is actually a riskier environment for managing critical content and information. That doesn't mean everything needs to move to the cloud.
Yeah.
You know, there are ERP systems that you maybe aren't going to get any performance value of that moving to the cloud. Maybe you want to get rid of your data center, but that'd be the only reason. But there are many applications where fundamentally it has to be in the cloud. You were talking about an example with healthcare.gov where that ability to have elasticity of compute is so critically important. And if you don't have that, then actually you're going to be wasting a lot of money in all of the cycles where there isn't a lot of demand for the service.
The part that I'm getting curious about is that, so we have the technology products, technology choices, and we also imagine over the past few days you've been talking a little bit about like different ways of building technology, right? The old way of waterfall, the new way of agile. How bad is it going to get? I mean, maybe you share your perspective, and I think I'll share mine as well too, but it's like, if we don't adopt these new technologies, these choices and ways of working, how bad is it going to get? Like, is it just we're going to be a few months behind? Is it like...
I think I would say that the big challenge is just what is the goal of the specific agency?
Yeah.
What are you trying to accomplish with technology? Are you trying to share and collaborate in new ways? Are you trying to work out to work with your constituents, whether it's the businesses that are your constituents? So if you're the FDA and you're trying to work with life sciences and drug companies, if you are HHS and you're regulating and working with hospitals, technology is going to be the difference between being able to do that very productively and effectively and doing that in a much slower way that doesn't keep up with the pace of change that those organizations are facing. One of the biggest challenges that we see is actually when we go to our private sector clients, it's actually the interface between that private sector client and the government agency where that is now beginning to break down. Where if you're a life sciences firm and you're trying to innovate and move to the future with digital or precision medicine, but the agencies haven't adapted their own regulations to be able to account for all of this change in the tech that is now possible because of technology, that's creating this huge, essentially, faction between the organizations that are being regulated and the regulators. And so we see this as a huge problem, and the only way that's going to be fixed is if we get a lot more productivity and a lot more innovation on the agency side. And clearly that's something you guys are doing on the digital services space. Yeah. I don't know what you're saying.
I mean, so that rift, that separation, I mean, you see it because I think more than ever, like the policies and programs that we have that are coming from the federal level, think even state and local government, technology is tied to them so integrally, right? Like before, we could live in a world where you could create an RFP, throw it over a wall and expect something to come back. But I think everyone in this audience either has a smartphone, an iPad, is using, you know, streaming music through Spotify or using tools like that, is that as a consumer, your expectations are so high for what technology looks like. In the enterprise, we go in and we're either dissatisfied with what we see there and the tools that we have, or as a consumer using a government service, you're dissatisfied because it doesn't look like your Uber app, or it doesn't look like when you go on Facebook or Twitter or things like that. And so this gap is happening, I think we've noticed, is because we're missing key people as partners in government. One of my best experiences of working with healthcare.gov was actually working with the folks at HHS and CMS. They're incredibly talented policymakers there that understand the healthcare system better than anyone I've ever met. The piece that they were missing was actually someone to help translate with the technology teams. At our tech companies before, there's a role for that. Either it's called a program manager or a product manager. These are folks that know how to translate business needs to the tech teams and keep that bridge alive. And so the United States Digital Services, this new, it's a new concept, but really what it is this movement of bringing in amazing technologists from the private sector into government. So far, we've been able to recruit, just in the past, I think about a year, about 150 people into places like the VA, working on the backlog and working on electronic health records. We've brought them into USCIS, which is our immigration hub, essentially to help modernize their systems. We're bringing them in as presidential innovation fellows, peppering them across government to tackle these large problems. By putting them there, they get to work with amazing innovators in government and upgrade everything together.
Yeah, and I've had friends kind of move out from the Valley to Washington. I don't know what brainwashing you guys have done.
We pay amazingly well.
Okay,
we can beat you.
And you have lots of equity, I think.
Yeah, tons of equity.
Options.
Karma points.
U.S.
Karma
bonds. You get bond equity. So I think that the big challenge, though, that we're going to run into is. This is happening in droves in the private sector, so you aren't alone in this, but like when we go talk to a very like knowledge worker centric firm, like a Deloitte or a McKinsey, one of their biggest challenges is talent. So they are running into this issue where they need to get the best and brightest in the world to come work for them over their competitors or over working for tech companies or other organizations. And the challenge is if they can't recruit, they can't retain, they can't get the best talent, if they themselves are either slow or not able to fulfill or accomplish the kind of goals that this new talent has coming on board. So there's a crisis going on in the private sector, which is how do you take a business that has existed for 30, 50, or 100 years and infuse new talent that is going to stay engaged, is going to stay collaborative, is going to stay productive, and they're actually realizing that technology is inseparable from the answer to that question. If they don't have the tools and capabilities and collaborative platforms that allow employees to accomplish what they want in their job, then they're gonna just lose that talent to somebody else. Mm-hmm. Because what happens is if you're coming out of college right now and you can go to an organization that is moving at the speed, sorry to keep on picking on you, Uber, if you can move at the speed of Uber, or you're gonna go somewhere that is going to be doing things in 3 or 5 year chunks, and you're not even thinking about your career in 3 and 5 year chunks, so let alone you're not gonna wanna go somewhere where a project takes that long, then you know the choice is pretty obvious of where you're gonna go.
Yeah.
And so we're gonna also see this rift between the kind of talent that is gonna be able to go into really, really large private corporations as well as the government if we can't solve this problem. So it's a pretty critical imperative to being able to, I think, make the government run better, but also to be able to get the right kind of talent into government that is going to be, you know, helping a lot of these organizations and agencies succeed in the future.
Yeah. The way Megan says it for us in government is like, we as a people make government what it is, right? It'll be as strong as the people that work there. For technologists, I think we haven't learned from our fellow colleagues in the legal profession, finance profession, or even in medicine, right? And for them in their careers, they see working in government or in public service as part of their career growth, right? I think for technologists, it's never been really an option put out there, and really has been because we've never asked for their help. And so my hope is, I think our hope, a lot of us in the digital service and at the White House, is can we create a culture of service from technologists all across the country? Can you spend a year or 2 years or even 6 months working for the federal government or a state local government in the capacity that you would work at, you know, a Facebook box or whatnot? And if you do that, we think we can actually upgrade governments at all levels and actually change the way that we do work. And so that's our hope and that's our bet.
Yeah, and that won't happen with today's procurement policies. Because literally, people don't want to do jobs where they can't make decisions for themselves. And this is a big challenge.
Yeah.
If you are not empowered to make decisions, to be able to go change, and that could be as simple as I need compute,
Yep.
To here's the software I'm going to build,
yeah.
then you can't recruit the best talent. And so the biggest challenge is this disempowerment that exists, where everything is sort of seen as one giant system where there are so many different checks
yeah.
and so many different processes. It's going to be really, really hard to get that Agreed. Talent and to retain it. So I don't know who in this room is responsible for this, but we've got to get this fixed.
Yeah.
So maybe we should do like a march on Congress or something.
it takes about 2 hours to march there. But
yeah,
like,
exactly.
It'll be
but like this is a huge problem,
yeah.
and this is I think going to be a crisis if we don't get some of these things resolved.
Agree. I definitely agree with that. I think it's not just on the procurement front, but being able to make choices.
Just procurement.
Just
That's
procurement.
The only thing we need to solve.
I'll push that a little bit because I think procurement is one part, but I think a lot of folks don't realize how much power they have within the vehicles. Sure, it's not perfect, and there's a lot of folks like in the digital service at 18F and GSA that are working on trying to make things better. The Agile BPA, which many of you here know a lot about and are participating, I would say keep pushing that group with your comments and saying what you want to see out of it. But I think part of it as well, too, is like we heard from a world of folks saying, hey, you need to fix contracting because we can't do Agile. And that wasn't true. Like the military had been doing Agile for the longest time and doing in some of their projects. And we released something called the Tech Fire, which says you can definitely do that. There were groups of folks saying, hey, well, I can't host on Google Cloud Compute, Amazon, Microsoft or whatnot.
Okay, fine. Difference. Fuck okay. Procurement. You guys got to do. You guys have to do more webinars then.
Okay.
Okay. Just educate everybody.
Educate. Yes,
okay.
It's the myth busting.
That's fine.
One piece. How much time? I'm trying to think how much time we have. I feel like since we have Aaron here, I want to actually pepper him with some questions that are outside of our world. Since this part of the day, I'm going to pepper him with questions first, and then we will. One more, two questions. I think one of them that I think you could probably help us understand more better than anybody else is this shift actually happening in the private sector into the more services model, right? I look at Adobe as one of the big examples of that have gone through that shift that's from old world to new. Can you share a little bit about that and what's happening? Because you've been doing it from the beginning, but what are you seeing out there? Because that applies to everyone.
So what's happening in the tech space is, and this is rippling beyond the tech space, but let's just start in the tech world. It used to be that if you started a software company or you started a hardware company, you sold a thing.
Mm-hmm.
You sold a piece of software that got deployed, or you sold a piece of hardware that got deployed. The customer was then responsible for integrating and managing that. And if 2 or 3 years later you had a new version of that thing, then you updated it or you tried to resell that to the customer. Obviously, in the shift towards SaaS and starting with Salesforce.com 16 years ago, the idea was, well, why don't we just deliver this as a service? So anytime that there's some new modern way of doing something, and now we're really on the clock because that modern thing comes every 6 months where there's a new phone, there's a new device, there's a new interface that you want to launch, SaaS is the only way to then make that possible. And if you think, when we go visit agencies, the amount of products that are running in those agencies that have the number 2003 on them,
the lifecycle model,
or 2007 is pretty massive, right? And that means that you have technology that is between 7, 10, or 15 years old, because it was probably anything that has a 2003 on it was designed essentially probably about 15 years ago.
Yeah.
So that's a huge problem, because in our software we update it every single day. So you're getting the May 20th, 2015 version of our technology tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just because we're always making small tweaks, small improvements, or big improvements that go toward making the technology better. So that's rippling through companies like Adobe, companies like Autodesk, obviously Oracle, SAP, and others. Some are doing it in a really, really substantial way. Some are doing it more in a surface way, because they have to change out a lot of the insides, and then they can do it more substantively. So that's a big shift. But the important thing, again, this ties into how I think the government needs to think about technology, which is you're not getting a thing, you're getting a service. And that means it needs to be consumed like a service, it needs to be procured like a service, it needs to be thought of and utilized like a service, and not utilized like a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think what this is also changing is it's changing a lot of non-tech companies and what they're delivering. So if you look at a company like GE, makes lots of big things. They make jet engines and healthcare systems. What they're realizing is that as those things are connected to the internet, then they're not selling just products anymore. They're delivering services. And so there's a huge amount of implications both for the vendors that we all collectively work with, but probably actually to the agencies themselves in terms of the mindset, which is we're moving to a service-based world. So it means that even agencies themselves need to be seen as services.
Yeah.
Which has huge implications for the technology leaders in these agencies, because it means you need to be thinking about how are you delivering a service, not how are you delivering products or just technology. You're delivering some kind of experience or some kind of ongoing service.
Awesome. And I feel like when a lot of hands went up with a question, so maybe we should go out to the group.
Cool.
Go for it.
Well, let me try. I am with NIH and actually part of the procurement.
Oh, cool.
At NITAC, so.
He used a profanity at you. So.
No, I said,
love it.
Yeah.
Love it. Love the observations. And the question is, and you've touched on a lot of this, but I think that, and we've been talking about white elephants in the room, it's everybody understands the need to innovate. I think everybody kind of gets that.
Yes.
I think you also have to, though we heard about, you know, the willingness to fail, you have to be able to own the failures in order to push through the big innovations. And I think that's the low tolerance. How in the federal government can we increase the tolerance for failure to push through new innovations? You guys have been talking about the same issue. I just want to expand on it.
I think it's a great point, because one thing that's very different about government versus the private sector is that we usually just get one chance to build something, right? There is only one chance to build healthcare.gov. You gave us 2.5 years to do it. They did it over that period of time, and it ended up what you saw on TV, right? I mean, in the world of enterprise tech, consumer tech, there are so many competitors that Aaron has. He has to continually improve, fail as many times as possible in little small micro ways to make sure his product is the best. Not enough of that is happening in government. And so we actually, I think, need to find ways to do that. If you look at even our counterparts that are not in the software realm, but are in like launching things to, you know, the space, NASA actually does things competitively, right? Like finding multiple people that can build things, trying to find out who can actually build it best, and slowly selecting winners. I think that's a model maybe we could borrow and adopt and try to use, but there's nothing I think that'll get us to the amount of competitiveness that happens out.
Well, and I think that even that mindset of thinking in services as opposed to products, because when you think about products, then you think about end dates. And when you think about services, it's a continuous stream of constant change. We don't even really use the word failure. Like what happens when we review something that doesn't get utilized, we just try and then figure out a way to get it used, or we try and figure out a new feature. We don't even say like that failed, because that's not even in the vocabulary from the standpoint of what we're trying to do. It was maybe the test didn't work. Or maybe that product didn't get adopted the way we wanted, but that wasn't a failure. That was actually just a data point to then learn from to go do it in a better way. And so,
how fast are you guys shipping, by the way? Like, how fast are, like what do your sprints look like, if you think about it? Like, I'm curious about that, because one of the things to get to that point is, in order to fail faster, you can't wait 2 years.
You can't find out all of a sudden 2.5 years later that the thing was like fundamentally wrong or right. Like, that clearly doesn't work if you're going to have this kind of environment. For us, we have everything in 2-week sprints. So that is the most sort of granular level that our development happens on. Mm-hmm. We push updates to the service every day, but there's a 2-week planning cycle that goes to sort of what we're going to be building. Yeah. And then we look at things as a quarterly basis to sort of roll up all of those 2-week sprints. And that's essentially the cadence and the operating model. So there's nothing that we have going on that we talk about for a year out, except for fundamental architectural things. Yeah. So you want to make sure your architecture has a long-term view, but anything that is going to be from a product standpoint that is getting delivered to the customer, we are looking at from a 2, 4, 6, kind of 8-week type of view, and then going from there, and then it sort of is rolling. Awesome. But yeah, I mean, this is going to be a huge cultural, I think, change to make this work.
All it takes is one Sony and people pull back. These are the things that are omnipresent, and they seem to impede the willingness to adopt.
Yeah, and actually, so this is, I mean, again, this is probably in the category of we're not going to be able to solve this today. But I think one big challenge that we have in government is, in the private sector at least, you have these competitive forces that if you screw up, you have two choices. You either do it better or you kind of get really constrained and you get really locked down. But if you get really locked down, what's going to actually happen is you're just going to miss the competitive transition. And so you can't afford to treat your failures as if sort of that's going to then slow down, you know, doing it again. Because what will happen is the CEO or the board will just say, no, okay, we actually just need somebody new to try that. So because there's no slowing down in the private space. So the question is, what is the force that is going to push government agencies and government technology, you know, given that there isn't that same kind of competitive dynamic. And right now, it's sort of requiring that you have a personal passion to be innovative and to move forward. And maybe there needs to be more systemic ways of solving this beyond just kind of willpower. But you know, ultimately, we have to find, like, what is that right way of driving innovation throughout government and making it so without innovation, that is a failing.
Yes, I have a question right here.
Go for it.
Yeah, I get the idea of consuming the service and software as a service, great concept. To me, one of the biggest challenges is to make this real. You have to interface with a lot of our legacy systems, and in some cases, legacy services. But for the most case, legacy systems that are 10, 15 years old. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, do you want to go first so I can think about my answer?
you know, the way that I think we're working around that is there are systems that are definitely from 10 years ago, 15 years ago, that modernizing them is going to be hard. But if you look at how much they're costing us, which is slowly incrementing up, because to find people that know how to use those systems, to be able to pay for that hardware that's now out of date, it keeps trickling up. And I think the only strategy that we're seeing working is taking parts of it and actually moving them away. Taking the old world, compartmentalizing them, then putting them to the real cloud, using more modern commodity-based kind of like technology choices is the move. Healthcare.gov is actually a great example where they've already started to do that. I realize, yes, it's only a four-ish year old product, but there were some architecture decisions that were made in the past that weren't the smartest, and now we're moving them to the better way, and we're actually following that pattern. The beautiful thing about old systems is that there are ways to plug in APIs into them for your new systems, and so you can start to make them talk. But it is that long-term view that Aaron kind of talked about, the architecture decisions are going to have to be one of those that are like 1-2 years kind of out.
Yeah, I mean, I think from what we see, and we're unique because a lot of the kind of capabilities that we deliver are at the end user level of the organization. So already, those have been somewhat disconnected from the core systems, and it's just that the end users, for the most part, I think the end user of government technology has been a sort of afterthought in the history of, I mean, this is true in the private sector, so it's not unique to government, but we didn't think about user experience when we delivered technology to employees. And so we're in a sort of more fortunate spot because a lot of our technology tends to be net new to an agency where it doesn't need to be massively plugged into the back office systems. It's actually intended to be more of a front office sort of end user technology. In areas where you want to plug it into the back office, that's where we have partners and system integrators that kind of make that glue happen. And I would say from a mindset thing, the most important is to really know when are the situations where you need to slow down the new thing because of the old thing versus when can you actually separate those as different parallel tracks. One of the big failure modes that we see is when you slow down your new innovation because you're trying to figure out what are you doing with the old technology, and that just ends up making sort of, you end up losing kind of the benefits of both of those worlds. You make the new technology worse because it's slowed down by the old technology, and then you're continuing to sort of breathe new life into this old technology that probably needs to be isolated and just shot. So, but it can't always be shot. Like, I'm sure there's some IRS system that we really can't touch. It just needs to be running with its cobwebs and you know, somebody's going to look after it.
Compartmentalized, yes. And fixed. Over here, I think there's a question.
Hi, Chris Dorbeck with GovLoop. First off, Ryan, I'm going to disagree with you on procurement.
Okay.
I don't think it takes 8,000 pages to say something that you can do. That seems broken to me.
Wait, so you're on my side?
I am on your side.
Wait, but I didn't say that, I don't think. I said
you
that.
Said, and we keep saying, and I think it's a problem if we keep saying it, because it acknowledges that there's not a problem. It's saying that there's not a problem.
Yeah.
If we have 8,000 pages, tomes,
that
says all the things that you can't do. And there are more and more procurement people out there saying, I can't do that because I'll be thrown in jail.
Mm.
Show me the person who's been thrown in jail for trying something new. You can't find them.
Yep.
But they say it, and it stifles innovation, creativity. Yeah. And my challenge to folks was, let's put the FAR in 10 pages. We know what the rules we want to do. Let's do it in 10 pages, put it on a wiki, and change it and update it.
That's a good point.
And stop saying that it's not a problem.
Yeah.
It's a big problem.
Yeah, man.
Sorry. So, let me hop off my soapbox and ask a real question of Aaron.
Go for it.
Well, which do you want to say that you agree?
Yeah, let me respond to those two blocks. I completely agree. I think we're trying our best with the power that we have, right? I can't change the FAR, right? I personally can't, but I can create that little mini guide called the Tech FAR that helps navigate that. I think one of the examples to look at where I think you see the digital service playing a role to try to help shape and change is the procurement that went out for rec.gov. Are you familiar with that procurement? And if you saw where it was in November of last year to where it's now, it's completely different. It's one that's actually using more modern development techniques. It's one that actually has an entry point for third-party developers to actually book, recreate, you know, rec sites and things like that. Take a look at that as a model because we're trying to replicate that. I think there's a, I think Justin's actually here in the audience somewhere from the digital service who's on our procurement side. There are folks there that are trying to make it better. And the cool part about this, by the way, is that all of the folks in the digital service are accessible. Justin, Tracy, and others, like reach out to them with your problems because I think now more than ever, I think we all can be pretty constructive of how to fix them. And because the one thing of like blowing it up, there are people at a different part of government you should probably be preaching that message to, but then in our part, it's like, help us make it more usable. But to your question though.
So my question, Aaron, is, so we keep hearing that the world has changed and now all the innovation is coming on the consumer side and enterprise is boring. You're on the enterprise side.
Yes.
Why and is enterprise boring?
He just called it boring.
I missed the last part. Did you say why is enterprise boring?
It is enterprise.
Oh, mostly I was commenting on the perception that I think the world has. I weirdly think enterprise is actually sexy,
yes,
which is very unique. But what is actually happening, so the consumer space for the past 15 years has been where we've seen most of the disruptive innovation. So, you know, on the social media side, Facebook and YouTube and Twitter and a bunch of others, on the consumer service side, Airbnb, Uber, all of these kind of new applications. But what's happening is you now have a crop of, I think, companies and startups that are realizing, what if we take the same principles that the consumer tech players used and bring those to the enterprise? And it used to be that that wasn't possible because your route to market was only through the CIO, and it meant that you end up having to specialize more in sales and procurement and negotiation than you did on the kind of on really delivering amazing technology, and so that didn't attract more product-oriented technology kind of founders. And so what has happened because of the internet and consumerization of IT is it's more attractive to build enterprise software because you can go and reach the end users of these applications. We have a freemium product, so we have 35 million users, end users on the product. We before we even had a single person focusing on the government, we had tens of thousands of government employees using the technology. So that meant that there was already a lot of signal that we could then go and focus on this market, but that wouldn't have been possible 5, 10, or 15 years ago. So there's just a big shift in terms of building technology for the enterprise. Yeah. Now that has finally caused CIOs and IT organizations to care about the same things that we care about. So they care about user experience, design, they care about openness and interoperability. These are the things that get technologists passionate about building technology. And finally, on the enterprise side, we're seeing that there's actually a huge opportunity to bring those consumer experiences into organizations.
My favorite thing about enterprise software, I mean, being like putting my, let's say, Outlook for Mac hat back on, is that the coolest part ever is that people are using your product more than Facebook, Twitter throughout the entire day, right? Like someone using Box, someone using Office, someone using Salesforce, someone using any of the tools that are in the enterprise world, they're spending more time on your tool throughout their entire day than they are on these consumer tools. And like that as a product designer kind of like mentality is one of the most exciting things ever. And I think that's actually why you're seeing so much good talent going to enterprise companies in the Valley or starting their own enterprise company because they see that, sure, now you know I fixed all the problems outside of work. Now I spend about 8 hours to 10 hours a day at work, right?
Right, might as well fix those.
Might as well start fixing those, and so that's why it's pretty exciting.
Yep.
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Aaron, you've talked a lot about end user experience and improving that, and Ryan, you've talked about healthcare.gov. So Forrester, in their eighth year doing a customer experience index, measured 935 brands worldwide. Across 18 sectors, government, federal government was 18th. The lowest scoring brand was healthcare.gov. So
I knew you had to be connecting those dots at some point.
There's room for improvement
at what
there.
What period of time?
I'm looking forward to seeing the scores this year.
Yeah, me too.
The top two were USPS and National Park Service, so if you're from those two organizations, you did an okay job. So and not a very poor job. So I guess my question to you, Aaron, is how does Box improve customer experience for your customers in an organization, or I guess not an organization, but in a sector like public sector, which really needs help?
Yeah. I
would love to take that question as well, too. How, like, healthcare.gov is improving.
Yes, why don't you cover that first?
Okay.
So that way we can get that fact on the record.
Perfect. it's a great point. I mean, I have a feeling that report probably came out between October and, like, January of 2013, right? Like, when it was at a moment where, sorry?
But it was probably on data that was old.
It was just published within the last 2 months. The survey was done in Q4 of 2014. Calendar
yeah,
year.
That's still pre so, the op- so. But the reason
not
I use
this,
that is
not
like
this calendar year.
The reason I use that is like the data point is that of course it was an incredibly hard experience for the American people to go to healthcare.gov and actually get affordable healthcare. You think about how the enrollment experience was this past year. You didn't see it in the news, right? Maybe minus one or two little days where there were little hiccups, but it ended up enrolling over 11.4 million people that went to find healthcare. I think your question, though, which was jumping to how are you continually improving the user experience, if you look at healthcare.gov last year, it took about, I think, 20 minutes and 80 screens to get through the application in its
wow.
worst like case. You're entering your social like three times, you're entering your name a bunch of times.
Yeah.
In the new
that's
world.
That's just united.com though. So.
I know, yeah.
Okay.
and in this case here, now, actually that is true. In the case that, in the upgrade that went around in this version, it was down to 20 screens and down to 12 minutes to be able to like power through. There's a great New York Times article that talks a little bit about the work of how the federal government is working to improve this experience. One of the number one phone calls that came into the call center were, is my doctor covered? Where is my drug covered? Like, I want to pick a plan that's for me. That's actually a question you can't really well answer even in the private marketplace. And so one of the things that's happening right now through CMS and the rulemaking process is they're going to ask all the health plans to put out a machine-readable format, the drug formularies and the doctors who are covered, so they can make better decision tools. The kind of neat part is they're maybe not working as fast as the cycles at Aaron's company is with Box, but they're really thinking about iteratively, how can we make this experience better and better each year? And now I'm thinking aloud a little bit. It's like if you think of the services model, this maybe is an example of like the federal government trying to adopt a services model where each year is a new sprint. There's never, I hope,
yes.
ever a stop of a investment period of like adding more functionality and features. And so to you, I guess.
Yeah, no, that's exactly right. We don't have version numbers in Box. It's because it's always going to be ongoing. We have 250 engineers every day. They show up and they build. They incrementally add on top of what we've created. Sometimes we kill things, sometimes we add things, sometimes we do something substantial, sometimes we do something incremental, but it's always going on. On our side, on the customer experience, we focus uniquely on blending the unique needs of a large organization that has a lot of security requirements, has a lot of compliance requirements, with the needs of an end user, which wants really simple technology, or else they're not going to adopt the tool in the first place. And so I think so for us, it's actually fairly straightforward in managing that balance, because we're patient, we think through the problem, we think through the complexity of it, and we try and build the solution that ultimately best balances those two requirements. I think what needs to change on the customer side, though, is we need to get out of RFPs, we need to get out of sort of like systems requirements, and we need to focus on the user experience of what we're trying to deliver. And the thing that kills technology in an organization in a user experience-led world is thinking about technology as a bunch of checkboxes on a piece of paper, and then somehow if the technology you get meets all those checkboxes, you've solved the problem.
Yeah.
Because that's actually just that's the baseline. And in fact, actually, many cases, the checkboxes are actually the very thing that are preventing the user experience. But that just depends on the technology. And so, you know, I don't know if maybe procurement needs to have a user experience component where you have, you know, UI, you know, people that are looking through that. But we have to get out of looking at these things myopically as you know, this feature is exactly the same as that feature, regardless of how it's designed. And in fact, a lot of cases, the RFPs that we see sort of assume that the process that you're trying to implement software for should be exactly the same with or without the software. So a business process that you just lay software on top of is only going to be as good as the process itself, ultimately. And so if you have a broken process and you have great software, you still are going to have a broken process, and that's the 80-page kind of... If you take your business requirement of, here are the 80 steps somebody has to go through to get, you know, healthcare, and then you just layer software on top of that, then you're going to have an 80-page or an 80-step software process. So the question is actually, how do we use more design thinking to figure out, well, what could we do to make that into 5 steps? What intermediaries right now are we having to go through that could be completely disintermediated? And that's actually the bigger change than just how is Box going to be designing its software. It's actually how are you going to be bringing technology into the organization, and what are you intending for it to solve?
The fun part is when you're seeing the policymakers sit alongside a lot of the user experience designers, because they're able to help shape that, right? Like, these processes that exist, they tend to be written out of
rules. Define fun part.
Okay. You know, I mean, like, it tends to be fun. I mean, like, in the sense that, like, the folks that we end up recruiting, like, for them it is, because it's kind of addicting. Okay. If you think about it, like, the problems that people have to come help solve, right? If you go to the Department of Ed, you're working on trying to tackle the student loan challenge. You go to the VA, you're helping a veteran get better health. Like, these are fun challenges because they're...
I just meant the policy person next to you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, there's a nice marriage between policy and tech, right? It's they're the lawyers we do enjoy.
I love building software with an attorney behind me, so...
I'll go on this side over here.
So it seems that the mantra in the federal space is that, you know, they don't want to end up on the Washington front page of the Washington Post, so that's a reason to not do something.
Yes.
But we don't hear a lot of those types of failures coming out of the commercial sector, and I'm wondering if that's because from building small and incrementally doesn't allow those types of big failures, or are you not at the same level of scrutiny that the federal government is getting? Yeah. Because we have public dollars that we're spending.
I'm so excited. And
you know, you please, you first. You this is you. This
if
all
we finally won today, do the answer. I mean, there are so many reasons for this difference is the challenge, and we should figure out how do we not how do we highlight more failures in the private sector, but how do we actually highlight more successes in the public sector and change the dialogue. Yeah. The reason why the failures in the public sector are highlighted is because it's people's dollars that are essentially seen as going to waste. In the private sector, if you waste somebody's dollars, you just get fired. And they just bring somebody new in to do that better.
Switch products.
And you switch products, you change things. And you do hear about it. Like, do you think that the person who developed Apple Maps is like, like has a really great career? This is off the record, right? this does happen. I mean, there are ways to be scrutinized in the private sector, but I think our challenge is we have an inversion. We talk about the wins in the private sector because these are what's developing the really amazing technologies that we all love to use. But in the public sector, we don't have that same kind of affinity to the different organizations. And so part of it is because we need better technology to build that affinity. But that is the kind of thing that is going to, like there's a way to make this be actually a virtuous cycle where it's cool to innovate, where the consumers do care, where the press does care, and we change the conversation away from either neutral to failure to being neutral to success.
Yeah. The one thing is that the feedback loop in the private sector exists, right? If things go bad, people will switch products. If it goes well, you get more customers, right? I think in the public sector, the failures are highlighted often, as they should be, because it is the people's dollars. I think the media is actually a really good way at keeping the public sector accountable. But the part that is missing sometimes are the celebration of the successes. And I would say that I've noticed a few projects sometimes overcorrecting towards where the negative noise is, because there's not enough positive noise, right? Like, there are teams working across the federal government, whether it's at TSA PreCheck or healthcare.gov or at the student loan sites, that don't know what they're doing well because not enough people say it, but they do know what they're doing wrong, and they're gonna probably keep going in that direction and not invest in the areas that we all love. And so that's maybe the piece of, like, how do we find a way to be holistically celebratory but incredibly constructive as well too in the kind of like get better side?
Yeah, I mean, I'd say this is beyond the IT side. I mean, we don't talk about the government positively enough in general. So that's just a challenge with the government.
Question over here, I think. Is there?
Actually, I've got one here.
Go for it.
So Aaron, you mentioned, getting back to the procurement side, Aaron, you had mentioned, you know, fixing the RFPs, right? And one of the things that we have seen glimpses of recently, which has been very exciting as a technology company, is that the proposal isn't actually a, you know, 30-page written proposal. It's actually software. So it's actually usable software, you know, functional software.
Yeah.
As your response. And so that's exciting for us. Obviously, keeping in mind, you know, that connection with the mission, right? Not just technology for technology's sake, or look what we can do, but understanding the mission too. So Ryan, I was interested in what you see going forward, if we're gonna be seeing more of that, and what your opinion on that is for the RFP process.
I think if you look at the rec.gov proposal, like take a look at that and see if that like hits the sweet spot of a better RFP. Because if it, look at the old one first, then look at that one to see if it's going in the right direction to say, hey, these are the things that were working well. But if it's missing the spot in the areas that you're identifying of either being overly prescriptive, being this more checklist versus like user needs kind of sense, I think that's actually the place to like constructively criticize us on at this moment, because our teams have engaged in that space. And so I would say look at that part. And
yeah, and I think actually what you brought up that I didn't even really touch on, which is the, you know, how you get into this, you get into unfortunately a very perverse cycle with the RFP model, because it selects in for vendors that of they'll just build all the features that you outlined, and it doesn't come together with a great user experience, because that's not what that vendor is focused on. They're focused on meeting and winning RFPs. And that is a very different kind of technology vendor than a company that builds great software that's going to be usable. Because it turns out that great software company that might be much more usable knows that a bunch of those check marks have nothing to do with delivering value for the end user. And that might be through just, you know, their experience with other organizations or industries, or just because they focus on the product and the user experience. And so it obsoletes a lot of things that were in that RFP. And so now imagine being a company that has better software, but it doesn't meet the check marks, you're gonna opt out of the entire process. So this is the negative cycle that we get into, which is the companies that are selecting into the RFP process are not actually the vendors you want to be working with. So, and that just continues to then increase and compound over time. So that's the big challenge.
Question, I would say like you're lucky in some way, but actually I should answer the question before saying you're lucky. It's like, do you have that negotiation process with some of the largest vendors you work with? They go, hey Aaron, Box, we wanted to do these things, like meet this checklist. Like, how do you have that negotiation? Because some of those items in this checklist, I bet your designers and developers say that's a horrible idea.
Yeah, but the difference for the private sector is we can go to the customer and have a conversation, and we can say, here's actually why you probably don't want those three or five things. They're gonna encumber this user experience. And then that customer gets to make just a risk-based decision on, do they want the upside of the user experience versus not having those check marks met. Unfortunately, the way that again, the procurement process generally works, or the bidding process generally works on the government side is, and I think with good intent, but ultimately maybe bad outcome, is you can't have that conversation as much. It is a much more a kind of black and white sort of, here's the checklist, and you either meet it or you don't. Maybe you don't meet it, but we're gonna go with the vendor that meets the most significant number of the requirements.
Hi, Aaron, this question's for you. So, you know, so you've grown a little bit since the time you started Box. How has your culture scaled, right? Has it changed since when you started? And if it has, then how are you going to keep that momentum as you all continue to grow? And more importantly, is it just stock options and money that motivates people, or are there some non-monetary incentives or techniques that you're using to keep that culture and that excitement going?
Yeah, so it's always hard to give advice on this dimension, because we do have an unfair advantage, because people love starting companies and they love joining a new, you know, crazy hot thing, and so there's some amount that people come to Box and they come to Silicon Valley because they just want to do something new and they want to grow it from zero to 100 or 100 to 1,000, and so that's exciting. That could be financially exciting, it could be personally exciting. That is an unfair advantage, and so it means that some things about our culture come from some things that are kind of, you know, unique to our environment. The thing that's not unique is getting people passionate about the problem that they're solving. That is going to be true of any kind of organization. And so what we spend a lot of time on is getting to the essence of what value you are going to be delivering as an individual in our organization, and how what you're doing connects up to the bigger, grander scheme of things. And that is incredibly important from a motivation standpoint, because it's not that interesting to be writing code for workflow software. Like, it's not that interesting writing code for compliance requirements. But what is interesting is when that workflow software is going to be used to power a medical process that could potentially save somebody's life. When that encryption technology is what is enabling the World Bank to use Box internationally all around the world. And so you have to connect up the small thing that you're doing with the really big thing that's transforming. And that's the main thing that we do in enterprise software, because a lot of times our engineers don't innately understand the requirements that our customers have. I can be on the road, they can't, so I get to learn what's going on and why we're building this technology. But if you're, again, building that encryption tool or that workflow tool, you don't necessarily live or breathe it every day. And so being able to drive that connection back to what is the thing that you're doing that is going to then transform a customer, that becomes very important. And I think there's a little bit of that exists for everybody, which is find the really unique technology-based story or innovation-based story that your organization offers that is the reason why people are passionate to come to work, the reason why they joined in the first place, and make sure that everything that you're doing connects back to that. And that's what we try and do at 1,300 employees, and certainly what we try to do when we were 10 people. And I mean, I don't know if you want to talk about why people join the USDS, because it's exactly for that reason.
It is absolutely for that reason, and it is that connection, right? When we talk to, like if you pick, if you throw out an agency, the mission of each of these agencies is incredibly powerful, right? If you talk about, like, Department of Transportation, what they do to keep the things working across the country. If you talk about the Department of Veterans Affairs, it's actually kind of amazing to see people working in the industries that they were before self-selecting to go work at the VA or to work at the Department of Ed or go work at Social Security. It is that mission. And I think also the cool part, too, in the government, it is that upside as well, right? At a startup, you have this ability to create something incredibly fast and do something disruptive. In government, you have this ability. You may not be able to do that disruptive thing, but you're going to move the ball forward like an inch, and that's going to change the world for the 300 million Americans that live in this country. And so that's the
scale
kind
of the impact that you guys have is massive.
One of our favorite recruits that we love to, there's a lot of them to talk about. One of them is Ellen Ratajczak, who is the third engineer at Amazon, right? She's the person that gets you those boxes at your door with the little smiley faces every single day. And after Amazon, her question is what is your second act? And she's come to the VA as part of the digital service to work there. And she, to her, this is a tour of duty that she's going to do, and then she's going to go back and probably start up another amazing company or go work an existing company to do big things. You know, you even have Eric Meland, who is director of operations at Twitter and Amazon. This is the infrastructure side. He comes into government because he sees all this low-hanging fruit to take the techniques that he knows to apply here. And when he goes to these areas, it's kind of neat. The engineers that I think we self-select for can see that dotted connection. I fix this boring process here, and some really amazing things happen on the other end.
Right.
Okay. Awesome.
Cool.
All right, I'll be nice this time.
What? How'd you get the mic again?
You just got to raise your hand.
Okay.
So
life lesson right there.
I entered the workforce in 1999, and the cool I entered the workforce officially in 1999, okay. When Napster was huge, and the cool part about working for a company like AT&T was T1 access, so you could rip CDs and do what you had to do, right?
Yeah.
Versus dial-up, or if you're, best case, ISDN. Do you see a day and age, Aaron, you have 35 million freemium customers and I guess the consumerization of IT, right? So all the cool toys went to the retail stores, everybody brought them into the enterprise. Do you see a day and age in the future where people are going to say, you know what, the cool stuff, not having my identity stolen, because all the stuff's secure at work, right? Can I get that at home? You do have the freemium model, but do you see a day and age where there's going to be really cool stuff at work that you're going to begin saying, hey, can I
Yeah, it's an interesting kind of thought process. That hasn't been the trend, obviously, for 15 years. People aren't my Lenovo is so cool, I want to bring it home. So I think, you know, we'll have to see kind of what that, how that plays out, or I really want like a personal ERP system for my finances. I think the use case that you brought up though was kind of true, which is there's things happening in the enterprise space that go to very unique problems in the enterprise, like security, mm-hmm. that will sort of cross that chasm into the consumer space.
And they are.
But it's not going to be. It likely won't necessarily be that you're using an enterprise product and thinking about it as I'm bringing an enterprise product home. It's that it's going to show up in our consumer technology. So the type of innovation that we're seeing in the enterprise space will then show up in your iPhone.
Two-factor auth.
Yes.
Gmail is a consumer thing. Facebook has it as well too.
Yep. And so it'll kind of happen, but it'll happen more organically because of the ecosystem. It'll be that some innovation occurs from a security standpoint that then shows up in your phone. The exciting thing I think would be going really, really far back, which is when can we get the innovation from the government space to then ripple all the way through both enterprise and consumer? Because that's when you're going old school, back to the kind of, you know, root of the internet. And that's the kind of innovation that would be pretty exciting to have ripple through.
My favorite story on that one is actually, of course, GPS, right? I actually found a full loop, because usually we used to always tell the story. Of course, GPS started out in the military, very expensive, then went to the commercial space, right? But in the military at the time when it was used, and in the commercial space, it was big, 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 like, headquarters, navigation systems, like, right, you needed a unit to operate it. But the consumerification of GPS moved it to all of the mobile devices that we have. Yeah. And in turn, now our troops can have GPS on their devices when they're out in the field, right? If you think about it, it's like only because of government, enterprise to consumer did it actually go full circle loop again. I think there are many more examples, but that's my favorite
one. I don't think the government's getting enough credit for drones. You guys have been doing that for years, and now everybody wants a personal drone. So I'd say that should be a campaign. Why don't we look at that as a success? The same things that shot down Iraq, now you can have in your home. So. Drone jokes, okay.
Okay. I'll let him make them.
Cool.
Oh yeah, one more
it's
question.
It's not like a requirement, I'm sure. We can.
Looks like we're good.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you. Cool.
Thank you.
That was about the best possible way I can think of to wrap this up. I want to thank all of you for your attention, thank them for a terrific conversation. Welcome Kathy and Kavita back to the stage to wrap us up.
Okay, please join me again in thanking Francis, Ryan, and Aaron for what was really... You know, we really, really appreciate your taking time out of your busy days to join us. That was so enlightening, just great, great conversation. Very fitting conclusion to what has been an extraordinary conference.
Thanks, Kathy. And before we go, I'd like to thank the Planning Committee and the ACT-IX staff who made this conference possible, all of you for attending and being active participants. And Kathy, thank you for all your support for making this event a success. And it's been a great partnership working with you.
And Kavita, I can't thank you enough for everything you've done and to make this just such an amazing couple of days. You are a one-woman dynamo. We've had a great planning team, but you've just done an exceptional job. So, thank you. And special thanks to Sonny. As I said, I think everyone knows, when Sonny made his transition to Box in April, I was asked to pick up the role and transition us to here. And this was a well-oiled machine, and it was really my privilege to do it, but it wouldn't have been possible, Sonny, without all of the tireless effort you put in before that. And perhaps most of all, we want to thank all of you for coming and for really diving in and actively engaging. As you know, we structured this conference with the assumption that all of you would be game to play, and you have. So thank you again. Before you leave, please be sure to log on to the app and complete the evaluations. We have box lunches, which I believe are outside, which you can take with you, or enjoy here, obviously enjoy on the beautiful grounds outside. Those of you in government who are attending the government-to-government session, we look forward to seeing you in just a little bit in the Schooner Room. Thank you. So again, travel safely home, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you for making this the best MOC ever.
Yeah.